Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. Here are some of the news items that we are following today. There are plenty of country songs about how to be a man. Well, by today's news, two individuals, Billy Graham and Ty Harden, came out as being gay. What is that actually going to do for their publicity and for their careers? You decide. On other interesting notes, well, to me, this is a little interesting. The question is, does two men or women kissing in public make you uncomfortable? If it does, apparently, you are not alone. We're going to be getting into that actual news story after the second hour of today's show. The music legend Cher, apparently she has canceled her Dress to Kill, or DTK, tour on doctor's orders. The legendary gay icon said that she was devastated and has pledged to finish this tour next year. The 68-year-old Dark Lady singer was given medical advice that she needed more time to recover from an ongoing viral infection. A total of 29 dates were canceled, including shows in New York, Boston, Chicago, Toronto, and refunds will be given. The U.S. Supreme Court has cleared the way for same-sex marriages to begin in South Carolina. The High Court denied a motion filed by South Carolina's Attorney General for an emergency stay to further delay the issuing of license to same-sex couples. A federal judge struck down the state's marriage ban last week, and it has caused, or rather, it was a file by Lombardo Legal on behalf of Kellen Colden and Nicholas Barclay. I'd like to have those two on the live show. This is heart-wrenching. If I've ever seen a heart-wrenching story, this is one. Of course, we have put the T in the LGBT on the shows prior. We've had a couple of our guests that have been transsexual. But this is an interesting newsworthy item. Nearly half of young trans people have said that they have attempted suicide, with 30% saying that they have done so in the last year. As the world pays tribute to Transgender Day of Remembrance, UK's LGBTI mental health charity, Peace has revealed new research that shows how difficult that it can be growing up as a transsexual. Isn't that something? Wow. What is this? The most prominent groups in America campaign against the legalization of same-sex marriage. They appear. Folks, this is insane. This group, the most prominent group in America campaigning against the legalization of same-sex marriage, appears, it says, to have financial trouble, with its 2013 tax filing document showing the organization is more than $2.5 million in debt. The National Organization for Marriage, or NOM, has managed to raise $5.1 million in 2013. It's a shame they didn't raise it for same-sex marriage, but rather they raised it against same-sex marriage. This is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. Stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen, with our special guest, Diana Finfrock. Yes, yes. And we're going to be having our special guest on in just one moment. Stay tuned. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are on the air in Seattle. Hey, I'm your host. A lot of people like me. Some people can't stand me, but whatever that the whole deal is, you know what? Everybody has something in their life that they enjoy, and everybody has somebody in their life that they don't. Hello, Diana.
Hello, how are you today?
You know what? I could be a little bit better, but I'm motivated to think that perhaps that we are finally on the cusp of something great. We were talking before the show about Texas and a lawsuit, I guess it is, coming before the courts there for January the 9th. Is that not right?
Yes, actually it was last February that Judge Garcia stated that the state ban was unconstitutional. It's taken this long, you know, immediate lawsuits were filed, appeals and all, but it's taken this long for it to even make it to the appellate court, to the Fifth Circuit. So January 9th, right now, is the date.
Isn't that something? Well, hey, I'm going to keep my fingers crossed because it's not just Texas, but it's Louisiana as well. And what
and Mississippi.
Mississippi. Isn't that
the important state?
Isn't that amazing? Now I am going to put up the little image slideshow of you. These images, folks, are provided by Diana Finfrock, and there is a book that she has written. Tell us a little bit about your book.
Well, the story starts with a gay high school athlete being bullied by the son of a prominent Texas politician, Ed Sloan. And the event goes viral, and because of this incident, Ed's wife Tammy finds herself on opposite sides of her powerful husband on this hot button issue, gay rights. And but Tammy finds her voice, and we follow her journey as she challenges her Christianity and begins to consider, you know, the entire LGBT community from a whole new perspective for the very first time. But that's not the only storyline. I introduce the reader to gay and straight individuals and couples throughout the novel and weave their stories together, showing that we're really more alike than we are different. We have the same hopes and dreams and values and virtues, strengths and weaknesses. I try to create a personal relationship for the reader.
Well, we've all heard the expression, the American dream, but historically, I mean, if we're to be open about it and honest with ourselves, we'll look at the American dream, which used to be, right, having the house with a white picket fence and 2.5 kids and all this. But you know what? It has completely left out the LGBTI community. But what about their dreams? In your opinion, where do you think that the LGBTI community stands today?
Well, I think we stand on the cusp of something very big. You know, change has already swept across our country really so incredibly fast when you look at the grand scheme of things. When I started writing my novel in 2012, there were only 9 states that recognized same-sex marriages or would allow them. Today we're at 35. Wow. So we're on the cusp of something huge and big, and I think we need to continue to be patient and let things happen.
You know, I agree. Folks, let me, because I'm just fixing to jump off of my chair, literally. Ladies and gentlemen, for those that would like to know, Diana Finfrock, she is from Dallas. And my hometown, where I was born. And her brother, her older brother, I guess he's your older brother, we won't say much about that. But her older brother, when I was a kid, I used to watch him on television. He was the meteorologist. He still is the meteorologist there, along with Harold Taft. And as a matter of fact, I had contacted several years ago WBAP, AM radio. That's Harold worked with WBAP. And they used to be a country western radio station, but now I guess they're news talk. Hooray. Just they need to air us, right? That's what it is. But anyway, I still remember, Dana, your brother on the air when I was a kid. And talking about a small world that just got a whole lot smaller, it really has. You know, being able to touch base with you, run into you literally through the website, and being able to be back and forth with you in email, I was like, wait a second, that name sure rings a bell, but that can't be. So, you know, it's amazing because your brother being in media for as long as that he has been in media, and now you being a book author, and you know, your life and his life, you know, obviously there have been parallel, but sort of in different, on a different plateau. What would make that plateau better for you?
Wow, I don't really know how to answer that. I'm not used to being on any plateau because I'm just regular people, as is David, really. He just happens to stand in front of an NBC camera every day. But he has been an incredible advocate for the LGBT community for really his whole adult life. Our parents taught us about justice and equality, and we all have been. But it's interesting how I purposely use all three of my names on the book cover, Diana Finfrock Farah. I'm very proud of that Finfrock, and it helps me, quite honestly, a lot in the North Texas area in any event, because everyone knows David.
Yes, they do. Well, you know, and a lot of people are going to get to know you, and I think that they should. You have something to share. You have something to say. And, you know, obviously not everybody in Texas, fortunately, not everybody in Texas has deafened ears to the actual battle cry from the LGBTI community. For all these years, people have been paying attention, and to me that is amazing. So what can you tell us about your book, and perhaps maybe how has writing the book, how has it changed or challenged your life?
Well, I tell you, my life has been completely changed, because really the idea of writing a book was never mine. It chose me. I didn't choose it. It was truly a calling, where I was told, you have a story to tell, and I expect you to tell it. And I was writing in 3 days, and I had the book finished in 1 year. I felt compelled to get it going, because so much was happening during the time I wrote it. It's a work of fiction, but based on true stories and current events. So it encompasses a lot of the change that went on during that time period, 2012 to 2013, which included the repeal of DOMA, the Prop 8, you know, Boy Scouts, you name it, lots of things. But it's changed my life, because I realize that part of the problem is that those of us in the LGBT community aren't always comfortable being open with who we are. And until the straight community gets to have a personal relationship with people that they may feel they don't understand and that they fear, you know, they're not even going to be willing to embrace change. So I think, number one, it's up to us to stand up and show we are your sisters, we are your cousins, we are your neighbors, we sit next to you in church, we work with you, and to help dispel that fear. I think that's the number one thing that we have to do. And then number two is to remember that as strongly as we feel about our beliefs, others feel just as strongly the other way. And it's important to start discussions, not just debates and arguments.
You're right. You're right. You know, I mean, if we look at it honestly, seriously, open-minded, what we see is the conventional, traditional church group that is, they are so perplexed by their own dogma, it is ridiculous. And what I find are a lot of hypocritical people sitting between the pews. They're saying no to same-sex marriage, no to gay people, period, for whatever that their reason is, but yet yes to other things. You can't necessarily have it both ways. And I find that there is time. And this is it, of any time ever in the history of the modern day church or religious groups. Today is a day for an absolute healing to happen, because, you know, one pastor a long time ago, she looked at me, she said, you know, I get so tired of being the only one that it seems that is picking up the pieces. People being shoved aside and thrown in the gutter, and here she is, she said, picking them up out of the gutter and saying, yes, you know, hey, we need you, we need this, there's something about you, rather than throwing everybody away because of their difference. Have you had that experience, Diana, where people looked at you and said, well, you know, I'm going to throw you away because I have no use for you, you're not like us, so I'm going to immediately judge you?
Yes, I've experienced both sides of that coin. My wife and I were on a cruise. As a matter of fact, one of the scenes in the book is this. I write from my life in a lot of parts of the book, where we were seated at a table for six. Well, they put us down at the table at four instead of six. A male and female came up and did not want to sit with us. The wife was clearly uncomfortable. And that was very difficult. She said the location was not what she wanted. Well, they ended up seating her like two tables down. And, you know, in a cruise ship, you know, you're this close together anyway.
Right.
So location really wasn't the problem. But as far as the Christian community, I live in a suburb of Dallas. have gone to the same little Presbyterian church for almost 30 years now, and my wife and I actually met there. We were married to men at the time and raised our families in that church, and now we are married. The congregation knows it, fully accepts us and loves us because they had that personal relationship. They know who we are. We're not scary. We're not evil. We're not any different than we've ever been. We're the same servants of Christ we've always been. And so kudos to our little church and a lot of communities. Matter of fact, I have a book club at another United Methodist church in town in about 2 weeks, and I've had several church groups ask me to come speak, which is fabulous. The tide is turning.
You know, I think so. You know, Donna, you hit the nail on the head. The tide is, and but you know what? I think that the appetite is so ripe right now, and so right for change. And we are just beginning to see it. You know, folks, when the Secretary of State, but the U.S. Supreme Court, when they overturned DOMA, which I had said years ago, back in radio and even on television, mainstream television, and I said, look, here's the thing, that when it comes to DOMA, that eventually that was going to turn and bite. Literally, President Bill Clinton right square the backside, because it wasn't right then, and it's not right now. And in 2 years, after all of the states say, yes, the same-sex marriage, lovely, right? Okay. But in 2 years, now this is going to be the laughingstock of how ridiculous that the whole thing has been when it comes to rights, Diana, is... In 2 years from now, after the fact that all the states have said yes, and it's law and order everywhere in the U.S., people are going to be looking back 2 years later and be asking themselves the question, what was the big deal? I can't remember what the big deal is anymore. You know, it's common day, you know. But I remember, Diana, when I was a kid, interracial marriage was a thing that you just didn't do.
And it was now, a felony.
Right.
And in my lifetime, too.
yes, okay. and today, it's common day. I mean, who really cares? If it's two committed adults that love each other, you know, what business is it if somebody else is to say, no, you can't do that?
Exactly.
So how has, I mean, your relationship with your partner, your wife, has had to have been so explosive in the last 5 years. What are maybe three major points of interest that has really impacted your life, personally speaking, in the last 3 years or so?
You mean points of interest from the current events going on?
Yes, you betcha. Something that has so challenged and changed your life.
Okay, the first one you already spoke of, the repeal of DOMA.
Okay.
Because we got married, we went to Canada and got married in 2010. And if you know your IRS rules, you can go back and file an amended return up to 3 years. Well, when DOMA was repealed in 2013, we went back and filed amended returns.
Awesome.
It was amazing. That's all I'll say. But that was, you know, one of the legal things that was a fabulous change for us. More recently, this past June, the Presbyterian Church USA, there are several different branches of the Presbyterian Church. We're members of the PCUSA, stated that ministers who are in those jurisdictions where it's legal, that they are allowed to marry same-sex couples. Mm-hmm. Which is fabulous. That means right now today, Presbyterian ministers in 35 states can marry and minister to those people in their congregation. Because like you said, it's been such a practice to deny the gay community, the transgender community from service and work and worship in the church. And I see that changing. That was the driving force behind the reason I wrote the book. I told you it was a calling, because I could no longer abide seeing the Christian faith that means so much to me being used as a weapon as opposed to being used means of inclusiveness and, you know, more truly following Christ's ministry, actually. But those are two huge things in our life.
You know, I think that in the last 2 years, we have seen such a drastic change in America. And the attitudes, the outlook, all of this when it comes to same-sex couples and their personal committed relationships. And, you know, you have a book that's out now. Where can people actually pick up a copy of it?
Well, I hope they'll look for it. It's on Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com. You can go through my publisher directly, which is AuthorHouse.com. And you can get paperback, hardback versions, or, you know, ebooks, Kindle, iPad, whatever. But it's available in all formats, and it's really making a difference because the target audience, quite honestly, it's those people who are struggling with the intersection of their Christian belief and, oh no, now I know someone who's gay, or I love someone who's gay, my son, my nephew. What do I do? It's for those people because, you know, it's so easy to take any verse of scripture out of the Bible and use it to justify anything you want it to mean. But if we actually look at the Bible in context and look at the overarching message of love and inclusiveness that is taught throughout from Genesis to Revelation, that's what we need to focus on. And that's part of what I challenge in the book. I try to ask, well, I don't try, I challenge the reader to engage in conscious thought about their beliefs instead of just knee-jerk, this is what I've always been taught, this is what I believed, so that's what it is.
You know what, I think that a lot of people are, you know, and correct me maybe if I'm wrong here, but a lot of people are so accustomed, they are so accustomed, so conditioned to judge, to hate, to use the Bible as a tool of destruction rather than as a tool of instruction. And, you know, I can't say that I believe one faith over another, or one principle over another. I'm not going to be that blind to say, you know, only it's my way or the highway, or you have to believe exactly the way that I do, or else what? You see what I mean?
Exactly. But then we're no different than they are, who are thumping us over the heads with a Bible. So.
Exactly. But you know what? The message of the Old Testament and the message of the New Testament, the Old Testament brought us into faith. It did not offer forgiveness. The New Testament does. And all things, and knowing and understanding this, that even Christ said that, you know, all things are fulfilled in him through his death, burial, and resurrection. All things are fulfilled, and they are. So why should we be bashing and hating each other based on an Old Testament custom? Well, if that's the case, then why don't men have 50 wives these days? You know,
exactly.
I mean, it's ridiculous.
Exactly.
So do you think, Diana, and let's touch on this for a few minutes, and then we will take our bottom of the hour break, but do you think that it is time for the American church, the American fundamentalist, to have a healing? And if so, what kind of a healing would you usher in for them?
Well, first, I would want to clarify that I see this as being two different arenas. The legal arena, where we've got all the court cases going, and that's one separate issue regarding civil rights. And then you've got the religious arena, which, you know, the government should not be telling the churches what they should be doing. I really honestly think that's up to the churches. Now, do I hope they come to a different, you know, outcome in their beliefs? Yes, of course I do. And that's why I think it's important for all of us in the gay community to stand up, show who we are, all the straight allies to stand up, say what they believe, to free people from, you know, that fear of, I don't want to be embroiled in this conflict, so I'm not going to think about it, I'm going to keep it at arm's length. We need people to talk about it. Brushing it under the rug is not helpful, especially in our churches. I agree with you. all different faiths. I have wonderful friends that are Baha'i and Jews, atheists, agnostics, and Christian. And just in the Christian faith itself, think how many denominations there are. So are we ever going to all really agree? Probably not. But is it too much to ask that we have discussions and we learn to respect each other and allow each other the civil rights and protections under the law and the opportunity to serve your God, however you want to serve him, call him, you know, whatever. So there's two things going on here, and it's time for both to have the discussions, I believe.
You know, it is, and I've heard the argument. Perhaps God was a female. You know, what would happen then? And somebody had asked me that question several years ago, and I said, well, what difference really would it make if God was male or female? Because I look at God, the entity of God, and I said, wait a second. You know, God is both male and female. He has feminine attributes, but God also has masculine attributes. If you read the Bible cover to cover, you will see at times that God is a fatherly figure. At times he is a brotherly figure. At times he is a motherly, a nurturing figure. So, I mean, not everybody is, of course, going to agree. They're going to be like, oh my God, I can't believe he just said that. Now your hair is going to fall out of your head. But seriously, you know, what people think of spirituality, I think that everybody deserves the right to be able to voice their opinion. But an opinion is not necessarily a way of life.
Exactly. And it's interesting that you bring this up. There was a very meaningful devotional I saw from Richard Rohr. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, R-O-H-R. And it came out just about 3 days ago on this very subject. And it talked about how gender is really kind of an accident of our human nature, so to speak, because what's really true about the human being is our authentic self, our spirit. And so even, I think it's the gospel, I forget which gospel, and then also, I think Gospel of John, Paul, and Jesus also all said there's no marriage in heaven, there's no gender in heaven. But we on earth get so stuck on our labels. We call ourselves this race or that race, this gender, that gender, gay or straight, rich or poor, because it helps us understand, but then we're locked in to those small-minded understandings we've just created for ourselves. So I just loved that devotional, though, where it said the mature spirit of a person can see beyond gender and see the other spirit of the other individual, which is what I think you were getting at.
Well, does God, does he see you as male or female? Does he lift up your skirt and see what you have going on? Or does he say, wait a second, does God say you're male or female, or does he say this is my child?
Exactly.
Now, if we're children of God, then I think it's time that we act like it. If we are, you know, if we're going to be the spawn of the devil himself, all right, you know what? We have enough of that already. We have enough people that stand in judgment and hatred toward the gay community more now than ever before. Interesting. Folks, there's going to be a side note to this story. So don't go away. Hey, Diana, let's take our short break at the bottom of the hour. And when we return, we'll get back into more conversations with you.
All righty.
On this. Hey, you bet. Folks, remember the book. Yes, yes. We're going to go through the slideshow. And we'll be back, folks, with the Robert Christian Show right after this. Don't go away.
Okay, I don't think I ever mentioned the name of the book. Okay, thanks. I'll mute myself.
Live in Seattle, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. Stay tuned, and we'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with the Robert Christian Show live in Seattle. It is a joy, of course, having everybody aboard. And hey, folks, reminding everybody that we are live here in Seattle on Fridays at 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. And in the second hour of today's show, we are going to be talking about what on earth is going on in Ferguson, Missouri, with the potential riot and protest. What kind of a message is actually being sent, and why is it being sent? That and more. And of course, we're going to look at President Barack Obama's statements last night on the immigration reform and the battle of immigration. And Dana, I'm sure that you can even identify with this. This is completely going in a different direction, but when it comes to the issue of immigration and the LGBTI community and families, for years traditionally it has not been such a bargaining tool, I guess, or concern, but it is now. What do you think of it? Do you think that that he went too far last night, or just right?
Oh, no, I don't think he went too far. And coming from someone who lives in Texas, and we have a lot of people crossing the border, illegally and legally, I think, you know, you've got to put yourself in these people's shoes for a moment and realize what they're escaping. And who are we to vilify them for trying to make a better life for themselves? I am full support of having them become documented and become full participants in our economy and as citizens. But in the meantime, let's treat them, you know, as the human beings they are, which is, like you said, what the LGBT community is hoping for as well. If, you know, you get back to what Christ taught, and he said, you're treating me the way you treat the least of those in your community. So if you don't feed the hungry, if you don't support the poor, if you don't respect the LGBT community, you're not doing any of that to him either.
Okay, you're right. Now let's on the right wing, and I know that you know who I'm talking about, and I've challenged him to go live with me on a show in an absolute debate, and guarantee you I would win. But he is from a little town in Virginia. He lives on a mountain. He owns a freaking diamond mine. But he is a religious knucklehead from the extreme far right. And he is, every time that there has been a natural disaster in the U.S., if it's been tornadoes in Moore, Oklahoma, if it was a hurricane that hit New Orleans, you know, he would always come up and say it's because of the homosexual agenda. Well, I never got that email. And, you know, so, but here he is. And, but a lot of the right wing are saying, you know, it's because it's God's judgment. And then you bring up, you know, I guess in a way, Sodom and Gomorrah, based on scripture. But the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah have never been found. And the only reference to them, to those cities, is in the Bible. Go figure.
Well, and more importantly, if you really look at what those stories are about, Sodom and Gomorrah, it was an issue of hospitality, which is, like I just said, treating the stranger as a friend. And that is another storyline, if you will, that you can find throughout the Bible. Jesus felt really strongly about that.
He did, but
strangers well.
You know, okay, for the far right wing knucklehead nut jobs, you all know who you are. We have a lot of viewers that are right wing, a lot of them that are left wing, a lot of them are sitting on the fence. But Sodom and Gomorrah were both destroyed. They were sister cities, sort of like Seattle and Tacoma is, or Dallas and Fort Worth. That's really what they were, sister cities. But they were destroyed not because of sexual immorality in the cities. They were destroyed because they were very wealthy cities but refused to lend a hand to the poor.
Exactly, a lack of hospitality.
Correct. Now, if this is here's a moat, I guess, in somebody's eye by me saying this, that if Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed because of sexuality, then why did Lot and his wife leave? When the Bible clearly tells you that Lot and his daughters had sexual relations after he was drunk.
Lot offered his daughters to the people knocking at the door first. So why do we not have an issue with that? So, you know, we're picking and choosing once again. And I think it all comes down to making sure we educate ourselves.
You're right.
Not afraid to speak our minds.
You're right. Now, Diana, let's talk about specifically about your book. We said before, just during the break, you said, oh, my God, I did not even say the name of the book. What is the actual name of your book? And again, you can get it on Amazon, correct?
Yes, it's The Door of the Heart. And you can get it at Amazon and BarnesandNoble.com. And really, like I said, I'm trying to help the reader gain a personal relationship with people that maybe they think they don't know, that they're afraid of, and they fear, and then you get desperate. And I think that's what we're seeing in a lot of the right-wing desperation lashing out. But if we can have discussions and actually get to know each other and realize that there's nothing to fear. Actually, we are stronger with our diversity than if we were just all the same. And so the book really helps start the discussion. And it's, you can identify whether you're gay or straight, whether you're old or young, male, female. There's a character for everybody. As we walk through the book, like I said, I weave many storylines throughout, but I leave the decision making up to the reader. I don't tell the reader what they're supposed to think. I present them with information and introduce them to people, and I hope they come to the same conclusion I do. But I'm not going to tell them, because I don't believe that's helpful in any way, honestly.
You know, there was a pastor years ago, and I'll never forget him, but one thing that he told me, it was one word. And you know what? At times there are words that are spoken to us, all of us, as humans, that challenge and change our lives forever. And he said one word. He said the word phanopy. And I looked at him like he was absolutely out of his mind. And he said the word means find a need and fill it. And it is so time that people not just say, oh, wait a second, there are hungry people in the street. But it's time to not just admit it, but to do something about it. Now, within the religious circles are the religious fundamentalist churches, etc., that are out there today, do you find that people are saying, wait a second, find a need and fill it? There is a need. For more mercy, for more understanding, for more respect, for more dignity, when it comes to the LGBTI community, or are they looking at saying, oh, well, maybe somebody else will do it?
Well, I think it's probably a little bit of both, because we are human after all, and sometimes we'd just rather pass the buck onto someone else, and yet sometimes we look around and there's no one on either side of us, it's us. And I think of these, who I'm going to call heroes, Jeff and Paul, Chris and Sandy, our plaintiffs from California's Prop 8, Mark and Vic, and Cleo and Nicole, the plaintiffs in our Texas case. These are just regular people who love someone and are standing up for their beliefs and asking the government to respect that. Oh, and let's not even forget Edie Windsor, who started this whole domino effect. I mean, talk about an unlikely hero, sweet little octogenarian Edie Windsor, who has changed the world, really. So I think it would be wrong for any of us, gay or straight, to step aside from the responsibility we have to each other in saying, we believe in you, we love you, we're okay with you. Just as I think it's just as wrong for us to point the finger at others and say, you are so wrong and hateful and ugly. That's what they're doing to us. So we need to rise above and show them who we really are. There's nothing to be afraid of. We're already here. We're already here. You just don't know it.
You know, I remember Pride festivals, and literally they are multiplying and multiplying, getting bigger and bigger and bigger. We have it in the heterosexual world. There is, well, I guess there is like the Rose Bowl parade in Pasadena and Thanksgiving Day parade and all this going on, and we can see this, and we at times are like, wow, that is a huge crowd. But you know what? The crowds at gay pride parades are getting very flamboyant, very out there. Dallas is one of them that is growing. When they started their pride parades, it was nowhere near what they are today. That's insane.
I tell you, I went to my first Dallas Pride Parade this year, and it was so much fun, and it was so encouraging to see the big corporations that were there. Not this gay group or that gay church or whatever. Huge corporations. I, you know, couldn't even begin to list them all. It was fabulous. And to see the diversity of people on the sides, you know, watching the parade go by, it was fabulous. I could say the same about Palm Springs. My wife and I were recently there for their Pride Festival and parade. And the diversity, the number of young versus old, gay versus straight, it was incredible to see so many people who are no longer afraid to go out in public and show who they are or who they support. And I think that's just tremendous.
You know, it is. You know, and I'm looking at the state of Texas in my head, in my mind. You know, Austin has always been very out there, very accepting, very tolerant, nice place to be, nice place to live. And now then Dallas. I mean, it has a huge gay population. Mm-hmm. And then I look at San Francisco. And a lot of people are like, oh my gosh, San Francisco, that place is just full of gay people. Actually, it isn't. I lived there for a time. Would I do it again? Probably not. But when I was there, it was during the Rodney King riots. Mm. So I covered it both in San Francisco and in Los Angeles. And so I saw that destruction but of what was going on. But I look at the cities and I'm like, wow, you know what? There is family there. There are people. And that used to be the term, family.
Right.
And I guess it still is. Is it not?
Yeah, I've heard that, and I've heard that term referenced a lot. And, you know, you spoke about Texas specifically. You know, we're a very diverse state, too. We've got, you know, the good old boys. We've got the urban sprawl. You know, we've got everything. And so, you know, you look at the big cities, Houston, where I was born and raised, actually, and Austin, San Antonio, Dallas, all very diverse and very progressive, honestly. Now, yes, pockets of major conservatism, but the big cities are completely different than when you get outside of that I-35 and I-45 corridor. And, you know, worlds are smaller, and you get the tradition, and I don't want to change, this is how it's always been, because that's really all a lot of people know, whereas big cities, you're changing constantly, so the thought of change isn't so scary.
Well, do you think that And you being from Texas, I lived in Houston for many, many years down there. Junior high school and way early high school years were all spent down there, just north of Houston, in the Woodlands of all places.
Okay.
But do you think that since the 1970s, that the attitude, the mindset, or the acceptance of Texans has become so different now than it was then?
I think it has everywhere. I don't believe Texas has, claim to that only, but I think just everywhere, because people are more willing to discuss and to, have that conversation with a loved one or a stranger. Whereas before it was just strictly taboo, and then if you did, you were putting your life in your hands no matter where you were in the country.
Now, why do you think it is so important for the right wing knuckleheads to decide that what they need to do is to go into your bedroom and spend the night there, see what you and your wife see what me and my partner, what we do? And I've threatened. I've said, you know what, look, hey, on the live stream, the live show, the live channel, boot it up all night long and just have the camera, live camera, in the bedroom. If people want to see what I do in bed at night, lovely. You know, I just like everybody else, you roll over and go to sleep, right? Mm-hmm. But people would be like, oh my gosh, I have to watch this to see if there's any action going on. And these are the same people that are trying to deprive you of your rights and me of mine. Why is that so taboo for them?
Well, I think it's part of the desire to be right. You know, we all have that desire. I want to be on the right side of things. I want people to accept me. I want to be picked for the team. You know what I mean? So I think it's our human nature that we want to be right. And especially if we've taken a stand on something, heaven forbid that we waffle. You know, we've heard that term in politics so much. Actually, I think it's a strength of character to be able to rethink something and come to a new conclusion. Let me share with you a quote from Socrates. I might not get it exactly, but he said, "The strength of our character is determined by the quality of our questions." So if we never question our belief system, if we never question our tradition, if we never question what we've been taught, how strong are we in those beliefs? And I think that's why it is so important that, honestly, people read this book, The Door of the Heart, because it makes people think. It's going to affirm the people who are more progressive and give them courage to either come out or speak up as a straight ally. It's going to challenge any right-wing, fundamental thinking people to let me put some conscious thought, let me question my beliefs. I'm either going to come out stronger in them, or I might rethink this deal. And that, of course, is what I hope. But we all know those people in our lives. Some of them are our family. Some of them are our friends. They need to read this book. It's really making a difference, because without conversation, we'll never get any further than where we are now. And the laws are changing every day across the country, but hearts aren't necessarily changing that fast. That's why we need the discussion.
You know, now, of anything that you would want your readers of your book to walk away from after reading it, what would it be?
To step back, take a moment to look at the person, the individual, the human being in front of you, instead of dismissing them as an issue or a conflict or some undesirable whatever that is threatening you. And I think it's important when we're looking at that individual across the table from us or wherever you find yourself, that, like I said, you put yourself in their place for a moment. Try to take yourself out of the equation long enough to really listen. Let's quit talking for a while and really listen to the other people. one of my favorite verses. It's Micah 6:8, and it says, "What does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God." So when we're walking around beating our chests, that's not very much of a humble walk with God. I think it's important for us to just live our lives on both sides of whatever issue it is, whether it's LGBT or immigration or, you know, race or poverty, you name it. Let's just live our lives as respectful people to the other person, and we can't go wrong. That's what I want people to come away in reading this book. Let's become better people.
You know, I would have to agree in the statement, let's become better people. And I can't say that the LGBTI community has not been realistic, because all along, and you know, as far as the gay agenda, again, I never received that email. Never
exactly.
Got the facts.
What agenda?
Exactly. I mean, is the agenda for the LGBTI community in the U.S., for an example, for equality, is that what they're looking for? Perhaps. Is it equality in just marriage? No. Employment? You know, in Texas, this is where I can pick on Texas, and I say shame on you, Texas, because in Texas, you can be fired for being gay.
Oh, sure you can.
In California, you can be fired for being gay. There is a multitude of states, Oklahoma, the same way, the same thing, but yet this is an oxymoron, because now Oklahoma has same-sex marriage, which is good for them, right? But they have this underlining law that says and allows these employers to fire you because you are gay. So,
and
hey, get married,
yeah,
you can be fired.
Yeah, and that is why we need some sort of uniform ruling from the Supreme Court to put this to bed. You know, just like women voting, the Emancipation Proclamation, you know, that wasn't Supreme Court. That was, I believe, a presidential writ, or what? Just like what Obama did with immigration last night. It was his decision. But with interracial marriage, all the same thing. The Supreme Court stepped in on all of those issues and gave us some uniformity, because, like right now, even with the repeal of DOMA, being in Texas, a same-sex spouse is not eligible for Social Security benefits. You know why? Because Social Security is nothing more than an annuity program, and annuities are insurance products which are regulated by the state. And so even if we file married filing jointly in your federal taxes, you can't receive Social Security right now because Texas won't recognize the marriage. So, you know, this needs to be fixed.
You know, one of the most ridiculous, and it's laughable, but one of the most ridiculous arguments against same-sex marriage in the U.S. was this, when somebody had said, the reason why that it is illegal is because of taxes. They can't figure out the taxes. They can't figure out how to tax both parties and all this stuff. And so because of that, that's the reason. And I laugh about it. I would tell you off the air, of course, who that actually came from. but I was like, really? Because people are so blindsided when it comes to their morality. I think that everybody's, not morale. Yeah, morale. When people are faced with decisions, and everybody is every single day, but they tend to argue. They tend to throw their temper tantrums. They tend to do all of these kind of things when something isn't quite going the way that they would want it. And if we look at the right wing knuckleheads that are out there, the religious right even, which we're finding out that the religious wrong, but I mean, but they, they're trying to stay in everybody's bedroom, and you just can't do that, Diana. You just can't. You know, I tell you what, you know, it has been a pleasure, of course, having you on the show, and watching your brother as a kid. You know, I'll never forget those moments in time. You know, I mean, who didn't back then think David Finfrock, right? Your brother. Whoops, I said his name. But you know, and then for you to be a book author, for you to be very outspoken in your community and doing what you're doing, I think it is absolutely incredible. So, what would you like to tell everybody as a last maybe 2 or 3 minutes before we have to end the first half of the show?
Well, I'll reiterate a point I made earlier. I think it's so important for those of us in the LGBTI community to stand up, be open, like you started at the top of your show, Ty Herndon and I forget the other country guy's name, but who've come out recently. You know, the Michael Sams, the Jason Collins, thank you. Let's not forget how difficult it is to come out in our own small communities, let alone somebody on that you know, level of national exposure, international exposure. So let's always treat the coming out of any individual with the respect that deserves. It takes great courage. We all know it. We've all done it. So let's remember that. And then also let's encourage our family members, our friends, to stand with us, to not be afraid, because as more of us stand up, the fear is taken away. There's the conflict isn't so big, and the argument isn't so scary. So it's just a matter of being honest, and that's what I would ask every listener to this show today to try to do in their lives. And once again, I'm going to be self-serving here and plug the book. Please get The Door of the Heart, because it can help you, and it can help you help your loved ones who may be struggling.
And again, the book is on Amazon.com, and didn't you say Barnes & Noble as well?
Yes, you can get it on, you know, a Kindle version, BarnesandNoble.com. So you can get them paperback, hardback, ebook versions, whatever you want.
Now, how much is the book? Do you know off the top of your head?
Well, I think they're discounted, and it depends on the day that you buy it. But the ebook version is $9.99 or $8.99, depending on the day, I believe. And the paperback is about $15, $16, something like that.
Not bad. Well, you know, a lot of people, they'll spend that easy at a movie theater or a restaurant, you know. So, hey, folks, do pick up a copy of the book.
And speaking of movie theaters, I did have the opportunity to plug the book to movie execs in L.A. Back in September. And I've got 5 different movie executives looking at it right now, the possibilities of creating a feature film or you know, a studio film of some sort. So that's exciting.
Awesome.
It's really an educational tool, and I know that's something you do on your show.
Absolutely. You know, we educate. We like to entertain. We have entertainers at times, celebrity guests that we've had on, and you know, I like to give everybody a little something from everything that we can. You know, if it's a celebrity interview, of course I enjoy doing them. If it is a book author, I mean, I like to get into it and see really kind of what's going on and ask the questions at times that other people find hard to. Because, hey, I'm inquiry. I want to know. If there's something I want to know, ask. You know what I mean?
I think that's fabulous. You're serving a wonderful cause here for everybody.
Well, I definitely hope so, and Diana, I cannot thank you enough for your help with what you do and your outlook on things, because, you know, even through your book, I think that people are going to perhaps read it and walk away from it and saying, aha, I had an aha moment today. Mm-hmm. So it was well worth it.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate the invitation to be here.
All right, Diana. Well, listen, I will send you an email, and you will get an email with a link for this video presentation in your email probably by the end of the day today. So that'd be great.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you so very much, Diana. And folks, it has been a joy having Diana on here on the Robert Christian Show. Wow. Can you all imagine what an incredible woman she is? Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they do matter. When we return, we're going to be talking about Ferguson, Missouri, and potentially what is going on in Ferguson. Ladies and gentlemen, the Robert Christian Show live in Seattle. Remember, ladies and gents, the only address that you need is robertchristianshow.com. Visit us, you'll be glad you did. All right. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, it is a joy. Of course it is to have you with us today. And I want to once again have a very special thank you to Diana Finfrock. She calls from Texas. And, you know, I'm persuaded to think that perhaps the Texas will, beginning at least by the within the first quarter of next year, have same-sex marriage there in the state. You know, so I'm going to be crossing my fingers, and as I'm sure that you will be as well. Folks, news that we are following, there are plenty of country songs about how to be a man. But one way to face the music is two country bumpkins, Ty Harden and Billy Gillum, who came out as being gay. In interviews from People Magazine and Entertainment Tonight, Harden had his revelation, inspired Gillum to do the same thing. Gillum posted a message on YouTube thanking Harden for making or breaking rather the ice. He preferred telling his fans directly in the comfort of home and sitting down, or rather, to sitting down, he says, with the press. Interesting notation. Does two men or two women kissing in public make you uncomfortable? If it does, apparently you are not alone. A report published by the American Psychological Review suggests that Americans are happy for gay people to have rights. They're just less happy to see the gayness shoved down their throats, it says, figuratively speaking. In a survey of 1,000 Americans, 70% said, 70%, mind you, said that they supported inheritance rights for gay couples, but are far fewer supportive of gay couples kissing in public. One of the straights interviewed, 95% said that they approved of straight couples kissing on the cheek in public, but only 55% approved of male couples doing the same. Okay. When asked if it was a lesbian couple, 72% approved. Over 20% of heterosexuals surveyed even disapproved of gay men, telling the respondents about their relationships. Cher has canceled her Dress to Kill tour on doctor's orders. The legendary gay icon says that she was devastated and has pledged rather to finish it next year. The 68-year-old Dark Lady singer was given medical advice that she needed to do more time to recover from an ongoing viral infection. A total of 29 dates were canceled, including shows in New York, Boston, Chicago, and Toronto. Refunds will be given. Okay. What is this? Interesting note. You know, as I said at the beginning of the first hour, the most prominent group in America campaigning against the legalization of same-sex marriage appeals to be in financial trouble, with its 2013 tax filing document showing that the organization is more than $2.5 million in debt. The National Organization for Marriage, or NOM, only managed to raise $5.1 million in 2013, of which half of that coming from just two big donors. That figure was more than half of what the organization received in 2012. The group released its tax filings so that donor names were redirected, more or less, to protect their identities from public scrutiny. Wow. Okay, folks, let's get into the issue of Ferguson, Missouri, and really kind of what's going on in Ferguson. Some people will say, yes, we are ripe in America. We are so ripe in the United States for a riot. Would you support a riot based on what is going on in Ferguson, Missouri, or would you say it's time for America to grow up and grow a pair and realize that, yes, maybe the officer involved in this was wrong? What do you think that the court is going to do? As of today, here he is planning on having the opportunity perhaps to leave his job with benefits. Really? Yeah, that's real. What do you all think? This is the Robert Christian Show. Wherever that you are, we are one click away. RobertChristianShow.com. And folks, we are back. I am looking at what's going on in Ferguson, Missouri, like anyone else is, perhaps, when it comes to this, because, you know, I look at it and I say, you know what, it is a disaster waiting to happen. The whole thing is, granted, I know the people are up in arms. They are awaiting the decision of the courts. They are awaiting to see really what's going on and how is this going to impact our nation? It is absolutely incredible, the amount of public exposure in one way or another of which that this entire trial perhaps could be given. And I know that a lot of people are sitting back on the edge of their seat just awaiting for a verdict of one kind, one type, or another. You know, it's crazy, folks. It is ridiculous. You know, we weren't there. I wasn't there. So I can't voice my opinion on if the officer is involved, Wilson, if he did it or not. I don't know. I wasn't there. I don't know all of the facts. However, I look at America and I say, you know what, America, it is so ripe. It has been so ripe for riots, you know, ongoing. So it potentially, could this be another Rodney King riot, another Rodney King issue? I don't know. I hope not. I hope not. But I do think that a lot of the police departments, that they really should be using non-lethal force if they had to use any force at all. Non-lethal. Of course, to get a point across, yes. To be able to make sure that an issue isn't blown up into out of proportion now that this one is. So was the officer, was he guilty of doing what people say? You know, I'm not leaving that up to the media to decide that. I'm looking in my own heart, and I've got to say, you know what, of course, looking back at it, there was another way of handling the entire situation. And America, it is so ripe for this, I'm telling you. So I hope that it does not turn into a literal bloodbath, because that simply would not be a good message at all. And speaking of messages, last night, President Barack Obama, he signed the executive order on immigration. We have had shows right here on immigration before, and I've said many times over that it is time for an immigration policy to work. It is time that the issue be resolved. And ladies and gentlemen, it's the truth. If we solely look at what the Republican Party alone, what they have done, and the way that they have held hostage the American taxpayer, if it wasn't the issue of immigration, they did not want to make a rule on it. They did not want to address it. They did not want to pass a bill. And that's simply put what President Barack Obama kept saying: pass a bill, send me something on my desk about this. And they have refused. And then you look at the issue of same-sex marriage in the United States. The U.S. Congress, I'm sure that they were shocked. They were quite disheartened, especially the Republicans, when it came to same-sex marriage, because the U.S. Supreme Court took up the issue. Now, you know, and yet they wanted to pass, the Republican Party, they wanted to pass. Fortunately, they didn't. The Keystone XL pipeline, which would have only created 33 jobs in the United States. 33 jobs, that is all. But billions of dollars are at stake in the Keystone XL pipeline. But yet the Republican Party, they would vote for that. And now, as of today, John Boehner apparently has filed suit against President Barack Obama because of Obamacare, or the Affordable Health Care Act. Look, ladies and gentlemen that really want to know, I have said this many times over, and I mean it. I absolutely mean it. That the Affordable Care Act, no, it's not the answer to everything. It is not the answer to every single issue when it comes to health care in America. I've said that. No, it is not perfect. It's far from it. But it is something, right? The Republican Party, they have wanted to challenge it, which they are. They have wanted to defund it, which they have tried 50-some-odd times already to date. There has been a lot of finger pointing when it comes to Obamacare, but yet they have offered nothing on the table as a replacement. There is no plan other than to dismantle it. You know, if it were left up to the Republican Party, they probably would even try to dismantle Social Security and offer nothing as a replacement. privatize Social Security. That's what they will say. You know, if you are of retirement age, well, you should have invested in your own retirement portfolio, and you take care of yourself. That way the government doesn't have to. I mean, I can already hear it. But ladies and gentlemen, the fact being the fact, the issue of immigration, yes, it is a very hot ticket issue. It always has been. The Republican Party has complained and said that President Barack Obama has overstepped his bounds by the signing statement, the executive order. But yet they fail to want to even remember that George Bush Jr. signed executive orders time and time and time again. He also had an order, an executive order on immigration. Yes, he did. So did Gerald Ford. So did Jimmy Carter. So did Bill Clinton. So did George H.W. Bush. They all have had signing statements. They have all had statements and plans when it comes to immigration reform. But this is the bad thing. The Congress, these yahoos in Congress who are claiming that they are a lame duck Congress, they have had more than one opportunity to make it right, more than one opportunity to pass a bill, have it sent to the president's desk, and they have refused for 50 years. Ladies and gentlemen, do you not think that it is time for these types of laws, bills to be passed? What do you think? Do you think that it should? I think it should. Good grief. I'm Robert Christian. On the issue of immigration and immigration reform, do you think that it is worth it? You voice your opinion. Chime in. Do you think that the issue of immigration is worth it? Should the issue be taken up by the President of the United States or not? You know, some people celebrate the idea and say, you know what, it is about time that President Barack Obama did do something when it comes to immigration. It is time that that he stood up and did something. But yet, when he does, I mean, for crying out loud, when he did stand up, and he said, more or less, the buck is stopping now. The freight train is going to get back on its tracks, right? We're going to get this thing right. And when he encouraged the illegal immigrants in the United States to stand up, be clean, do what needs to be done, be here for at least 5 years, right, in the U.S., have no criminal record, you know, I think that that's good. Now, could he have gone further? Yes. Do I think that he could have gone for? Yes, of course. You know, folks, I've said before on the live shows and quoted, if you're going to quote me, make sure that you do it right. But I've said on the live shows that you know, if it were me, I would pass legislation. I would pass the law, if I could, to something to this degree, for the on the issue of immigration, that for those that are in the United States, those that are in the United States, and those that are taxpayers in the United States. Now, surely not all immigrants pay taxes. But for those that do, those people that live in the United States, that raise their families here, give them something better than a green card. Give them the opportunity to work, to be educated, to learn English, and give them the opportunity. And in 1 year, 1 year's time, give them 1 year to pass the citizenship test into the United States to become U.S. citizens. And upon completion, the federal government give each one of them a thank you gift of $10,000. Listen to me. A thank you gift of $10,000 and say, welcome to America. Here is our vested interest, or a token of our vested interest in you as a new American citizen. And to say thank you for wanting to become a member of our society, of the United States. Give them a reason, not an excuse. A reason to remain in the United States. It should not just be because of education or health care. A lot of people are so frustrated, and the only two elements that they can see on the issue of immigration is the money. How are we going to afford the immigration, the immigrants? And then look at health care. What about health care? They come across the border, they have a kid, hey, they're socked into the United States. So what happened? You know what? There are a lot of families, folks. There are a lot of families of which that are bilingual families. A lot of families are split apart literally by a border. And that is ridiculous. But if we are going to close the border, if we're going to close the border, ladies and gentlemen, to the south, then it is only appropriate to close the border to the north as well. Now, if we close the borders off, completely close them off and say no more immigrants, period, we're going to keep our people in and prevent them from going out. And we're going to prevent other people coming in. We might as well become like North Korea. Ouch, you say. I can't believe he just said that. Yeah, of course I said that. We might as well then become like North Korea if what we are going to do is to close off our borders and prevent growth. Folks, look, I am not... I don't look at the issue of immigration and say, you know what, it's a win-win or it's a happy-go-lucky thing. It doesn't really matter. Of course it matters. But in all of our families, every one of our families, we're immigrants or strangers to the American continent at one time. Every one of us were. So what makes you think that by President Barack Obama's executive order yesterday, last night, what on earth do you think is so wrong with that? When every other president in the last 50 years has had executive orders, in so much that 11 of them, yeah, 11 of them, I believe the number is, where it presently stands, has had executive orders specifically to deal with it. And the Republican Party are like, yeah, what it's going to do is open up the borders wide for people to come into North America, to the United States from Mexico. Okay. But you know what? There are fewer people from Mexico crossing the border into the United States now than since the 1970s. And to that I agree. Now, what about the crime rate in the United States? Look, if somebody is in the United States illegally, they're working, they're paying taxes, right? You know what? I back what President Barack Obama said. He could have gone further, though. Yes, he could have. But what good would it have done? Now, was that really a slap in the face to the American people, or was it just a slap in the face to the Republican Party? You got to remember that Mitch McConnell, he is one of the yahoos of which the President Barack Obama has said, or that said, no, we are not going to work with him. We're not going to work with President Barack Obama on anything, because guess what? We don't like him. You know what? I don't care if he likes him or not. He's obligated by law. He's obligated to work with him, no matter if he wants to do it or not, agree to it or not. Wow. Live in Seattle, this is The Robert Christian Show. And a special thank you, ladies and gentlemen, to all of you who helped to make The Robert Christian Show a leading voice for the LGBTI community in the United States. It's a great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to have you all aboard today. And let's celebrate diversity. Let's look at what's going on in the world that we live. And let's try to make it one day at a time a better place. And, you know, that's what President Barack Obama last night was trying to do, and I believe that he did, is that he made America a far better place for immigrants to call home as of last night. He did. You know, look, he could have said, for the right-wing knuckleheads that are in a traffic jam mentally, you know, he could have said, you know, I'm going to grant complete amnesty to all of the illegal immigrants here. Guess what? Welcome to America. This is now home to you. You are now a U.S. citizen. He could so have done that. Or could he have? You know, look, he didn't say if you are here illegally, oh, guess what? Come morning time, you're going to be here legally. You're now a citizen of the United States. Welcome to America. He didn't say that, did he? So do you think that he went too far? According to the Republican Party, the polls are suggesting, yes, he went way too far. Really? But did he really? I don't think so. I think that he was right on target. You know, and of any other time, of any other president or occupant of the White House, I think he was. Now, people may not agree with him. They may not like him. Well, guess what? I didn't ask you if you agreed with him or if you liked him. We're not talking specifically about him, but we are talking about immigration reform and how should Congress enact a bill, legislate a bill, that would sooner or later become law, perhaps if it were not vetoed when it comes to immigration. And the sad and sickening thing is, we haven't even covered this yet, and I hope that you all are ready. But we haven't covered this yet. The problem with Congress, here they say, oh, we're a lame duck Congress. Quack, quack. Right? We're a lame duck Congress. We can't do anything. Look, Congress has not wanted to work with President Barack Obama since day one. Mitch McConnell, the Republican occupant person, die. He said, look, we have to just make sure that President Barack Obama only serves one term as President of the United States. Give me a break. He's a one-termer. Oh, really? But Mitch McConnell, guess what? And then John Boehner. Both of these knuckleheads, and I call them knuckleheads because they are. How could they not be? I look at what they're doing, and I'm so offended. I really am, because they're simply put, they are not representing you, they're not representing me. So who are they representing but corporate interest? Bullseye. Bingo. Yeah. That's exactly what it is. It's the corporate interest. And they're like saying, you know, wait, we have to hold on. We got to wait. Because it's the corporate interest that we are out after. But by the way, we're lame duck Congress. But yet they vote for their own vacations. They vote for their own pay raises. Do they really? Sure they do. This is the Robert Christian Show. The only address that you need is robertchristianshow.com. The issue of immigration reform in America, wow, you know what? Nobody has a clear answer to it. They really don't. So let's focus a little bit of attention, folks, the last half hour of the show, on the issue of Ferguson, Missouri. And perhaps really what can happen or what should happen when it comes to the officer, the police officer, Wilson, that was involved in the issue there in Ferguson. What do you all think of it? I said earlier in the show that I felt that America is so ripe for a riot, for a civil uprising, and it is. If we want to face the music and say, yes, hey, I agree to that, or not, it is. But you know what? I can only suggest perhaps the way that I personally feel about it, and this is what I think about it. That America, it is so ripe for it. But I think what is going on is that America wants change, and it, really, if it's not a change via Congress, if it isn't change via the White House, if it isn't change on those levels of our government, perhaps it is change that America is seeking at a lower government or by our local police departments, local leaders. Now, you know, I've heard, and a lot of people have said, that a lot of police departments, if you're going to be a cop, if you're going to be a police officer, then guess what? You're crooked. You're so wrong. But you know what? I find the contrary. I absolutely do. Yes, there are some bad apples in the bunch. There always is. But you can't judge an entire department based on one officer. You can't base hatred or judgment calls on a city based on what type of people or income of people that live in that city. You can't do it. You know, look at Beverly Hills. You know, you think, oh, Beverly Hills full of rich people, or Boca Raton, Florida, another place, and say, you know, old money. You know, hey, hip hip hooray for old money. But just because there's money in those two cities doesn't mean, really, that it is a good place to raise a family. Not necessarily. So I look at both sides of the coin. Now, when it comes to the issue of what happened in Ferguson, you know what? I have come to a grandiose conclusion to say this. Realistically, yes, it could have been handled differently. It could have been. The loss of life in American streets, the loss of life in America for any reason, it's sad. It's sickening. It's disgusting. Yes, of course, he could have used non-lethal measures to have taken care of the issue. Of course he could have. But he didn't. So, whose fault is it? Is it the officers or is it Brown's? You know what? I think on both instances, the whole thing could have been dealt and handled way differently. What do you think? Folks, when I look at the aggravation, and America is so aggravated. America is so aggravated because of what happened, and I rightly cannot blame them for their aggravation. But I would say this, you know, there are, and I looked at a list yesterday. It was yesterday. Let me actually bring this up just for good measure. Because there was a list, for those of you that want to know, for those of you that have inquiry minds, there is a list. Bearing arms, right? Here is an insane list. Activists deliver a pre-write demand to police departments. And I read the demand. There's 19 of them. 19 of these demands. And you know what, folks? I look at this. Yeah. I look at this and I'm like, are these guys really super serious? Well, their first priority, they say, they want, and as I'm reading this, that shall be the preservation, right, of human life. Okay. Channels of communication will be established so that situations can be de-escalated if necessary. Okay. Reasonable. The police will give protesters a 48-hour notice before the grand jury decision is announced. Okay, this is what they're wanting. Okay, every attempt, number 10, I'm skipping a few. Every attempt will be made to pinpoint arrest so that the only individual lawbreakers will be arrested in the mass arrest will not be used. Okay. Safe houses shall be considered as sacred ground only and only entered by police when called upon in an extreme necessity. Okay. Media and legal observers shall not be considered participants in protests and shall be allowed to do their jobs freely. Okay. You know, what's funny? Shocking. That some of these paid protesters. They say, you know what, look, mainstream media, they are the arch enemy of, well, the Occupy. Well, I was told that, right? But let me make this perfectly clear. That what is going on, what has happened in Ferguson, Missouri, it is of zero reflection of the Occupy people. It has not been the focus of the Occupy Wall Street to do anything when it comes to Ferguson. Yes, Ferguson, Missouri, what happened there, it was bad. It was horrendous, no doubt. But it has no effect on the Occupy. Again, but what people are doing, they are trying to turn it into an Occupy Wall Street event. The rancher in California, remember him? Bundy. The Bundy Ranch. That whole deal. They tried to turn that into an Occupy Wall Street event, and it was not an Occupy Wall Street. Occupy Wall Street was a financial deal. They were going after Wall Street for the financial corruption and collapse of the American dollar on Wall Street. It wasn't like, oh, this was a bad thing that happened, so let's go protest this. But now what is happening are these other groups that are forming and saying, hey, now because of what happened in Missouri, let's have 100 plus city event. So because a snail was crossing the road in one city, suddenly we have to have snails crossing the road in every city. And so what I find is that just because something happens in Ferguson, then surely something is going to happen, i.e. a protest, i.e. a riot in Los Angeles or in San Francisco or even Seattle for that matter, you know, in solidarity with, you see. Does that make it right? Surely not. And you'd have to be brain dead to think that it would make it right. Look, we live in a society that is so soon enough turning into a lawless generation, and there's something definitely the matter with it. I focus the attention in this aspect on the officer that was involved. Now, if he had to do it again, do you think that he would? I don't know. What do you think? Folks, I don't know the answers. All I can do is address a truth or address an idea and say, present it to you and ask you, what do you think about it? Do you think that it is appropriate? Do you think that it is right? Or do you think it's a failure? And to what extent? What has failed the American populace? Has it been Congress? Has it been the president? Or has it been the American people that have given up on each other? Ouch. Too many people have given up on each other. I'm telling you, they have. They have given up on you. There are people that have given up on me. For what reason, I don't know. I'm not even going to worry about it. But I will tell you this much. We need to get real. We need to be for real. And we need to understand the rightful issue. And in this case, with Ferguson, Missouri, it certainly is not Occupy. What's going on in Ferguson? Yes, it's bad, and it can get worse. Let's just hope it doesn't. I'm Robert Christian. Well, for those that would like to know, I posted on Facebook earlier today. And you can follow us on Facebook. But I posted, I said this earlier today, that many people that I know feel that President Barack Obama overstepped his powers when it came to his executive order. Again, we're talking about immigration. Last night on the issue of immigration, according to what I'd said, he has every legal right to place such orders. Yes, he does. If you, Congress, or anyone else agrees or not, it is not the issue. The Republican Party has had more than enough time to pass a bill to address the issue of immigration. Oh, boy. And they have refused. And yet, some of the people that you voted into office, these are some of the people that even you voted into office, not out of office, that are holding this thing up. So I salute President Barack Obama for his stand. America is better than this, isn't it? This is the Robert Christian Show. Wow. Here in Seattle. Hey, it's a pleasure having you all aboard today. And, of course, our special guest that we had earlier on in the show, Diana Finfrock. And, yes, as a matter of fact, I did watch her brother years and years ago in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. As he was and he is still the meteorologist, or a meteorologist there, for the NBC affiliate. And, hey, that was great. Talking about a small world. So, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to riots, what do you think? Do you honestly believe that having a riot or having a demonstration, having a protest, do you think that is sending a message? And A, to whom would that message be sent? And B, what message is it? Now, if we're sending a message and if we're showing the world, and I've heard the expression, this is what democracy looks like. Okay. If it is what democracy looks like, why then does democracy, why is it so latent with fear, with hate, with anger, with violence? Is that what your form of democracy looks like? I don't think so. Now, not everybody, of course, is going to agree with my interpretation of it. My form of democracy, and as I look at democracy, is freedom. We all want and deserve freedom. We live in America. We live in a free country. We live in a place, in a society at large, where we should be able to be who that we are. However, the right-wing knuckleheads are out there and saying, no, you have to be who I tell you that you can be. And then we have incidents like what has happened in Ferguson, Missouri. Does it make it right? No. Do I support the officer in his decision of doing what he did? No. Do I support the idea or the people that would be involved in potential riots or potential acts of anger, acts of war? In the U.S., no. Do I think that it is appropriate for the community at large to stand up and say, you know what? Look, we have to raise awareness because we are mad, and so we're going to burn buildings down. No, that's not appropriate. That's not right. Look, we're not always going to agree. But when it comes to the issue of Ferguson, Missouri, yes, I look at it as in dismay. But the whole thing does not revolve around what happened in Ferguson. Yes, it's bad. Yet I know this. But when it comes to the appetite for anger, the appetite for bloodshed. Right? For mass arrests, for all the, you know, it's like this. Hey, let us protest. Oh, we're fine. Then we get arrested not for protesting, but for breaking the law. You get arrested for it. Then suddenly, then that's a whole new issue, and then a new twist, and then a new thing. Tune in next Tuesday, right? Tune in because the pot just deepens. It, you know, hey, there's something else going on, so it's a new twist on things. This also happened. Somebody else got in trouble. Hey, so because of that, let's cause yet another incident. Do you see what I mean? And people are building and building and building and building. You know what? It's time to stop this. The demise in America is going to be because of hatred. It really is, and we need to stop it. I don't think, you know, look, you might be a protester. You might thoroughly enjoy a good protest. And I've seen this. People say, oh, you know, hey, it's boring around here. There's nothing to protest. Oh, come on. Life is more than just a protest. It is. However, I do not agree. I don't think that it was appropriate at all. And I said that earlier. It's not appropriate what the officer did by any means. No. I feel very bad that happened. And I do believe that it could have been handled differently. You bet. Would I have asked for that officer's resignation? You betcha. You bet. You know, I would have, you know, look, if I was the mayor of that city, I would have fired that officer. There is no question about it. Because they should not just be taught to fire a weapon, but they should be taught when not to. Now, you know, this angle, that angle. He shot Brown from this distance, and this is what happened. The blood splattered, right? This was the gore A lot of people they look at this and say, yes, let's really dive into this. Let's get the gory details. Maybe the truth, in a way, is going to come through these gory details. I don't know. But I can rest assured to tell you this. America, it is better than that. And that we must look at what has been going on in America. We need to look at what's going on and say, you know what? There is a time for change. We need change, of course, in our world. But what's going on in Ferguson, God only knows. Maybe you know. Maybe you have something that you want to say on the issue of Ferguson, Missouri. Hey, if you do, feel free to email me at robert@robertchristianshow.com. As we're talking about Ferguson, Missouri, we'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this to wrap up the show. Folks, it has been a very interesting week, to say the least of it. I think it has. News is always the news, but you know what? There isn't a day that goes by here that I don't at least try to stay abreast as to what is really going on. Hey, next Friday, before I forget, this upcoming Friday, we are going to be doing a show, which really I could do at any time of the year, but we're going to be doing a show on Black Friday deals. As it has been in the news that two of the worlds, or one of the world's number one top retailer, and then a secondary retail box store, is requiring their employees to show up for Thanksgiving and work Thanksgiving as part of their Black Friday bucket deals that you can find at the stores to try to persuade families, hey, shopping is better than Thanksgiving dinner together, really. Well, so we're going to be going into it and asking the question, getting into the issue of Black Friday deals, because are they really worth it? Do you actually save money on Black Friday deals? I have a hint for you, and the answer is no. You really don't. But what it is, right? What it is the more or less a regurgitation of the sell paper from the lowest price of a product during the course of that year. That's exactly what it is. So, hey, if you want a 90-inch LCD flat screen TV, show up at this store, limit one, okay, and very, very, very small print, limit one per store or per state, and only available between 12:01 a.m. and 12:02 a.m. The first two customers will get this for $99. Okay, limit one per store for 1 minute, right? Okay, so you have 1 minute to go from the front door back to the back to claim the item, go to the cash register, and check out before. Can you do that in one minute? Okay, and this is what angers people. It really angers a lot of people. So why would you want to spend time away from your family shopping for Christmas and not spending time with your family on Thanksgiving? So Black Friday deals, is that really a good thing? Well, we're going to get into it next Friday. Good grief. And folks, we have upcoming, let me take a look at the calendar. Okay. Yeah, I can put that up in here. Wow. You know what? Yes. Where is it? Here it is. Taking a look at our calendar. Wow. We have a very good guest coming December the 5th. Vincent Roslin. And we're going to have a show on the issue of cannabis. Yes, 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 we are. And Brendan Corey was here last week. Woohoo! David Pissarra, attorney at law, was on the 7th. That was a lovely show. You know, we have this year for the Robert Christian Show, it has been a phenomenal show. Lucas Corvetta was on. Hills Pugh was on. Dan Dotson from Storage Wars has been on. Wow. Renee from Storage Wars. La Rosa Edwards has been on. Oh, boy. David Bowers was on. Talking about a police state. Yes, yes. Wow. Nicholas Wildstar, governor. Nicholas Wildstar. He was running for governor of the state of California. He was on. Oh, boy. Who else? Eva Gantz was on? Yes. Dr. Simon. Yes, he started his shows. Bruce, the love coach, was on. You know, Zach Phelps. We have had an incredible amount of people, folks, that have watched the shows this year, that has frequented the chat room, that has gone to the website, that have used the this, and you know it is totally, it's amazing, you know, at the people that we've had on as guests, and next year we're even planning on even more. I'm going to take this year, the week of between Christmas and Thanksgiving off. Hooray, hooray. Christmas and Thanksgiving. No, between Christmas and New Year's, taking that off. So that's going to be great. You know, I can't wait for a little bit of time. Yes, I can or can't. So, hey, folks. You know, it's a joy having you all aboard for the Robert Christian Show, reminding you the only address that you need to find us online is robertchristianshow.com. In Seattle, 206-736-9688. Turn up your volume and listen. You bet. So, folks, we've got a lot of things, of course, going on between now and the end of the year. Wow. So, hey, I enjoy hearing from you, and I would love to hear from you. So, of course, send us your email and let us know what you think. Voice your opinion, your concern, because, hey, that is where it is at. Well, hey, folks, I hope that you have enjoyed today's show with our special guest, Diana Finfrock. And, you know, as I did, I learned something from her. And, you know, I like to take something away from all of our guests at the end of an interview, the end of a show. Take something away and say, you know what, hey, I'll learn this. I can hold on to it. And one thing for sure is that we all can hold true to the course of our convictions, stay true to the course of ourselves, and be ourselves in this world, which at times seems to be a world of uncertainty. I'm Robert Christian. We'll see you next week right here on The Robert Christian Show.